So now, is there a big celebration at Rolling Stone because of the triumph of the Michael Hastings story on General McChrystal?
You know, I'm remote. I'm out here in San Francisco, and everybody else is in New York. I think this is everyone's taking in this moment and sort of relishing our place in the history of the progression of that war. This really is just a pivot point in something that's much bigger than ourselves. So I don't it was never the intention to go and scalp anyone. I hope that people now that McChrystal is gone will go back and read that story and it's full and very disturbing picture of the war that it paints, because the indictment was not of McChrystal in any way. More it was the indictment of the policy that he's been tasked to, and now Petraeus has been tasked to implement, which is failing miserably.
Well, it's all part of a larger story about America's addiction to carbon, particularly to oil, and you've got a new story this week in Rolling Stone talking about kind of the new frontiers for our oil addiction, which is the next old lady that we've got to mug to feed our habit, and that's the Arctic. And you've written a really great story about the plans by the oil industry, particularly Shell and BP, and how they're escaping regulation in the Arctic that probably should apply to all oil companies right now. Tell us about that.
So the Shell has a plan to drill in the Arctic, and the permitting that it's gone through is got through sort of every hoop except for the final one, and they were sort of scheduled to begin drilling in June, but the permitting that they went through under the Bush administration and then the Obama administration after the some of the Bush stuff got thrown out in court, it doesn't contemplate a blowout. It considers a catastrophic blowout too remote to contemplate, and so it's not included in the response plans.
Let's set the stage. For many years, environmentalists have been fighting over drilling in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, which is a major refuge for caribou and for polar bear and for Arctic fox and many other species, muskox. But this is something different. These are new plans for the oil industry to not drill in the refuge itself, but to drill in the Beaufort Sea and in the Chukchi Sea offshore. And
right.
This is something that has not been done before. And what the Shell has done is, while most of the oil drilling itself is frozen in the Arctic, they're actually creating dry land by piling rock piles
That's BP's approach, which is sort of even more disturbing. The Shell deal is pretty much standard offshore drilling, and it's not covered by the moratorium because it's in shallow water. But they sort of saw the wisdom and a cooling off period. But there seems to be, I talked to Shell about this and talked to the administration, and there doesn't seem to be any indication to say, hey, we need to rework these environmental permits that are, in just sort of a sick joke in the aftermath of what we've seen. And so that's disturbing. And that as soon as these 6 months are over, a lot of people are predicting that the administration is just going to go ahead and give Shell the green light with the assumption that what's going on in the Gulf will be capped and people's attention will be onto the next crisis. But BP could actually be, ironically, here's the repeat felon that's created the largest environmental disaster in our nation's history, isn't covered by even that sort of informal suspension that Interior put in place in the Arctic. And so, they've made a permanent offshore rig by dumping, gravel into the Chukchi Sea or the Beaufort, and then it's going to drill from this sort of permanent offshore facility, which it qualifies as onshore drilling because it's on an island.
They've connected the island with the causeway to the mainland.
Right, and so that causeway runs, the pipeline and some road, 3 miles back onto shore. And so they're gonna from this sort of spit of gravel out in the sea, they're gonna drill down 2 miles and then drill out laterally, horizontally, about 6 to 8 miles until they can tap into these reserves in the Arctic. And that project isn't subject to any suspension and is likely to get and is eligible to basically, the administration won't say that they will put up any barriers to this. They say, when we get these final ask for the go-ahead, we'll consider it then, and that, which is just sort of inconceivable to me. If you can't say no to BP at this moment in time, I don't know when you're ever going to say no to them. So,
and this is experimental technology, really. They're pushing the outside envelope of what's ever been done before in terms of lateral drilling.
Right. And, it's sort of all the elements that led to the disaster in the Gulf are present here, where you have, equipment that's going to be, so the engineering is out ahead of itself. These people have got, one of the BP guys, Doug Suttles, who's down there, lying every day in the Gulf, is saying, called this as sexy as it gets in terms of the technology that they've got. And the New York Times did a great follow-up sort of piece on this, looking at the dangers of gas kicks, the things that, cause the Deepwater Horizon to explode. And apparently they're much harder to sense and respond to as you're drilling horizontally somehow. It basically, the same sort of dangers that caused the disaster in the Gulf are present in the Arctic. And then should something like what we're seeing in the Gulf now happen in the Arctic, the capacity for humans to respond to that in any meaningful way are just, it's laughable. It's 1,000 miles away from the nearest Coast Guard station. There are no deep water ports. The nearest cache of boom is 2,000 miles away. It's the capacity for people to respond to this disaster is minimal, which means that the Arctic wildlife and the native peoples who depend on this ecosystem are just going to bear the brunt of it and perhaps irrecoverably.